Hey folks, Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? Hope you're all doing very, very well. And welcome, one and all, to another magazine edition on the Kilt-Man channel. Today is the 25th of April, 2023. And just to start off with, down in Australia, they're celebrating ANZAC Day. Australian New Zealand Army Corps commemorative day. For this day in 1915, they stormed the beaches and then engaged in trench warfare with the Turks on the Gallipoli Peninsula of Turkey. And whilst the English were sitting drinking tea on Suvla Bay, they were getting massacred left, right and centre. Today's a massive national holiday in Australia, and our good friend and channel supporter and contributor, Scrowy, has been out enjoying themselves. Because that's what these guys gave their lives for freedom, for the ability to do that sort of thing. And it was a bloodbath, it really was. Like most of the Great War ended up being anyway, a complete and utter waste of human life. Facts and figures, folks. The Australians lost 9,000 killed and 19,000 were wounded. This is just Gallipoli. The New Zealanders lost 3,000 and had 5,000 wounded. The Turks had enormous loss of life and wounded as well. It was carnage. But today, on a glorious day there, Scrowy, our friend and his family, have been out and they've been part of the celebrations and they've had a meal and they've gone out to, I think, is it North Head, I think you call it, and they've seen some wildlife, you know, some stuff in the bush, and had a great time. And his son was climbing over one of the big cannons that does support Sydney Harbour, you know, as a defensive thing. And I've just been talking to him actually, and I was saying, I remember being in Monaco and Monte Carlo, and whatever that big castle-y thing is called, which I can't remember. And my kids were only young, Lucy would only be about 4 years old, so Luke would be 10, and they're doing the changing of the guard, and they're wearing them big sort of like, you know, Rumpelstiltskin sort of Persian style, I don't know, curly cue boots on, and they've all got loads of ridiculous colours and huge big flintlock rifles and silly kepis on with like little tassels hanging off them, and they're doing this slow march. Well, it's not slow march, it's quite ridiculously like a Monty Python silly walk. And I know it sounds like I'm taking the piss, I am, and but I'd seen kids playing on some of the cannon over yonder in this big courtyard. So my kids climbed up on a cannon on our side, and this one of these guards, when their ceremony was done, came over. I was in a kilt and I was topless as well, which I only learned afterwards that being topless, which you think, you know, hang on, this is the entirety of the south of France, bordering onto Italy, and you've got Saint-Tropez is just up the road, topless bits and bobs, jiggly about all the time. And my movies were out, and I didn't know that was wrong. I didn't know you couldn't do that. No one actually told me until afterwards. But you don't stop a guy in a kilt, you know, you don't. Well, this guy tried to, but in his own language, he was, which I'm not even sure was genuinely French. I know a smattering of French, and my wife speaks French and German and Spanish, you know, so she can bollock me in several languages and does so frequently. And she was actually laughing, which is unusual because normally she doesn't like any kind of hassle or confrontation. And but my kids were like, basically was told to get off that cannon. I thought, oh, okay. But I'd seen kids over yonder on another cannon. So I thought, you're playing at, you're letting them do it. So I was just going, hey, what's the rumpus? And this guy in his silly sort of ornate, lots of ruffles and stuff, and like, you wouldn't go into combat looking like that, you know, unless you're a drag, it's drag queen wars. And he's mouthing off, and even though I'm a short ass, and I was taller than him. His musket was actually twice the size of both of us put together. And I was going, oh, what? And I got the kids off, and like they were like, what are we doing wrong? And then he turned around, a big battle face, his knees were up to his ears, marching back to his little pillbox thing. And this guy, who's British, come over, but he said like, and he was laughing. He said, oh, by the way, I know what he was telling you to do there. And I went, oh, go on, spill the beans. And he said, oh, in front of the kids and your wife, I can't repeat it. I was like, oh, Jesus, was he really that annoyed? Because when he was doing this bollocking, he had a big smile on his face. He said, no, that's what they do. That's what they do. He lived there. He lived in that area. And but he was only going there to do some gambling later on, like one of these rich. Had a yacht somewhere around there, like, but he found the whole thing very amusing himself. But I was going, like, but the kids over there, he said, yeah, but they're locals as well. So they let them off. It's just you being strangers and you in the kilt, you know, you stand out like a sore thumb. So there is a photo. Mrs. Kilt-Man took a picture of me getting roasted by this, what do you call him, Monarchan, Monte Carlin? I'm not sure what you call him, actually. This guard berating me. She took a picture, but it's a proper hard copy picture. It's on a proper camera, not on like your phone. She took a proper picture. So I've got to try and find that somewhere. It is amusing. But anyway, so Scroey was commemorating Anzac Day, and we all doff our caps because the sacrifice the guys made in the Great War, the Second World War, any bloody war you choose to mention, should not ever be forgotten. Without their sacrifices, we wouldn't be able to climb on cannons and to celebrate and have meals and put flags out and have the freedoms that we have so far in today's world. Don't get me started on the encroachment of our freedoms. Nope. Not doing it, not going there today. No, not going there today. So, Anzac Day. And a great movie as well, Gallipoli, Peter Weir, Mel Gibson, and Mark, the guy's name now. And poor Mark gets machine gunned, and Mel Gibson's doing the thing to Adagio for strings. And of course, you've got Jean-Michel Jarre, you've got Oxygen is in there as well. And Gibbo's, he's the runner, because they're both runners, you know, they both competed against each other. It's a wonderful, Peter Weir's movie is wonderful. And, but, you know, Mark Lester beats him, and he's been trained to run barefoot as well. But Gibbo, his character, is also a bloody good runner. But he's got to relay the messages. And like, look, you know, this is a suicide mission. Go and tell them, get them to stop this. Call the charge off, like they're gonna go over the top, and his buddy is gonna get killed. So he's gotta stop this. But it's Sniper Alley and there's Turks sniping at him, and he was still trying to get around all this. And then, but he gets back to try to call the charge off just a second too late, and the whistle's gone, and they've gone over the top, and they're all getting, the Turks are laughing and just machine gunning, taking them all down. But Gibbo's mate is running, and he's even unarmed, he's dropped everything, and he's just running because it's just what he's learned to do. And it freeze frames. It's a brilliant movie. It's very stylized. It's funny in a lot of places as well, but it's also a great early movie for Mel Gibson, showcasing his ability to act. And and as I say, wonderful soundtrack as well. It's not inappropriate whatsoever, you know, using electronic progressive rock synth soundtrack, as well as orchestral classical music. It works, and it tells an incredibly powerful story. And but it doesn't gloat on it. It doesn't overplay. The way it stops with a and the screen goes to goes to red and ochre, and then black and white, I think, and the freeze frame of him being machine gunned and his death. And you've got Gibson, in the trenches screaming. Gibson is great at portraying incredible angst and anger and raw primal rage. and grief. He's absolutely brilliant at it. I've discussed that before, actually, about him. And he's in the trenches, going, oh, no. And it's just, oh, God, it gets you. So, Anzac Day. To all the Anzacs. Brothers in arms. Rest in peace, fellas. So, we also had, on Sunday, just gone, we had the Armageddon alert. We had the UK's putting out of the alarm to everyone with a smartphone. You're gonna get this alarm. Oh, they touted this, touted. And yet, on every TV program where they mentioned it, they said, but there will be people that won't know about this and they're gonna panic. There'll be old people who don't even know how to use their smartphones. What this is, folks, in case you didn't know what it is, and a lot of countries have got this. It's in Scotland. Oh, the irony. Oh, the irony. It's been in Scotland for a while. It's been all over America. It's in Australia. It's in other countries. They've done this. And it's a national alert system in case of, you know, really, really bad life-threatening weather and floods and that sort of thing. Earthquakes and terrorist atrocities and threats. So in theory, it's a wonderful idea, but it also then shows that the government knows where you are. And although I've been told in the last few days, no, they're just going off the phone masts, so anyone in the area will get that call. But, you know, being a very sort of, I don't know, cynical bastard about governmental motives, very ulterior motives, especially post-pandemic and lockdowns and new laws that came in. Well, I didn't like the idea of this, did I? But anyway, it happened on Sunday. And it really wasn't that spectacular whatsoever. It just wasn't. What happened was, like, at 3 o'clock on Sunday afternoon, we got Husky Dog just trips past there. You know what's coming next. I got it in the back door for her. There's always someone, isn't there, going to try and steal the show. If need be, she can go outside and do her thing. It's a gorgeous, gorgeous day. But yeah, so 3 o'clock, this alarm went off, and you're just meant to like look at it, and it just says, oh, this is the test of the government alarm alert, Armageddon, you know, system. Do nothing. And like, have you received this? Press okay, douche. It's off, it's gone. And the thing was that it would go off, even if your phone was sort of on silent, it would still go off. The only way to get around it was to turn your phone off altogether, or to go into your settings and turn off emergency alerts. I never fucking knew I had a setting for emergency alerts, but apparently I have. But that every phone's different. It's a different sort of thing. And anyway, in the UK, certain pubs around the country had banned mobile phones in sort of rebellion against this. They banned mobile phones, you know, for all of Sunday. You know, there's people eating their roast dinners. They didn't want this fucking alarm going off, and everyone's going, dropping their phones in the gravy and the mint sauce and all that. So they banned them. And there's a backlash against that, actually, which I noticed. You know, well, they're just being stupid. You know, that's overacting. The whole fucking thing is overacting anyway. If there's a flood near you, I think you'll know before they notify you. If there's a fucking tornado coming towards you, I think you'll know before they let you know. You know what I mean? No, it's... they'll use this for other things. Anyway, besides all that. So, but I was kind of like, well, let's see what happens. So, on the day and the time in question, my phone and my son's phone didn't go off at 3 o'clock. They went off at 2:59 together. We were like, shit, it's not even 3 o'clock. And it weren't that loud, And it just flashed up and went, yeah, it's just a test. Went on for like, I don't know, 10 seconds, not even that long. Okay, got it. Yeah, no, but Mrs. Kilt-Man didn't get the alarm until about 3:07. And even then, she got the actual visual message on her phone. But there's no alarm going off. No alarm. Now, it doesn't matter if your phone's on, it doesn't matter what your settings are, you've got it on silence, it's going to go off. But it didn't. My daughter's phone, she got nothing at all. She didn't get a message, she didn't get an alarm, nothing. Now, I may have got this wrong because I meant to try and have a look at this the next day, see what everyone was saying in the mass media about it and all that. I know I hate the mass media, but really, no way of finding out, really. And I saw nothing apart from someone said, oh, apparently 40% of people in the country never even got the fucking alarm. I don't know how true that is. I don't know how true it is. I've asked people in the pub yesterday, did you get it? And in my own little sort of, I don't know, did you get it? Yeah, oh, I got it, yeah, at 3 o'clock. Yeah, no worries. Did you? Did you? Oh, you didn't. So there were people that didn't get it. So that was just in a little enclosed environment. Hardly a huge sort of very clinical and mathematical approach to studying the response. But yeah, but I've not heard what the government has said about it. Oh, it's just teething problems and some people didn't get it. Some got a delay. I don't know, different networks picking up at different times. I don't know. I don't know how it works. But it was a complete and utter fucking storm in a teacup. So if there's a storm in your teacup, is your alarm going to go off? There's a storm in your teacup. Quick, run away. Run away from it now. It might spill upon your kilt. In theory, I believe in an alarm system. In its sort of, its general premise to warn you, don't go down that street because there's a fucking giant gorilla down there destroying buildings. So run that way. Go west, young man. And that makes sense. But I also do not believe, I'm very jaundiced when it comes to government sort of policies and them telling you to do things. Hide, go back to your house, nothing to see here. Just go indoors, go into your bunker and don't look out the windows because we're moving tanks up and down your streets to enforce martial law in the morning. I don't know. But my mind thinks like that. So, and having worked with tanks and the government and the military, having served in the military, I know what they're fucking capable of. Change all. God, that's not looking good, that is it? But it is tasting good. That's the main thing. So, yeah, the alarm. I know in Scotland it's been in action for a while. Sitting in America, it's used. Canada, I think it's used. Australia, it's used. So it's, but they have been for emergencies. But I do suspect massive manipulation and a very cynical abuse of this new power that they've got. Anyway, right. Oh yeah, there is something big at the moment. Speaking of wars, we have civil war in the Sudan. And East Africa, not a massive surprise there. We've been there before. The British have been there before in the Sudan. And had some horrible, horrible campaigns and battles. And about, I don't know, was it 2-3 years ago, there was a political coup which overthrew the government. And it was between the Sudanese army and this rapid response. Oh, I've written it down. What are they called? Rapid Support Forces Group, but it's the RSF. And the army overthrew the government and they've been in power. And but the two rival generals have fallen out very badly, very violently, and with huge ramifications for the area, about integrating a civilian government. They have not agreed, and it's brought out bloody all-out civil war, Lots of shooting on the streets, lots of aerial combat, lots of gunfire, artillery fire, and massive loss of life. Now, the thing about this is there are many, many people from all around the Western world who live there, expats and people working for embassies, Germany, France, Spain, Italy, all were very quick to evacuate their people, not only their working staff there, but the people and their families who were just living there from their countries, and did it in the last couple of days. Now, at the weekend, because this is how quick this happened, at the weekend, all of the British embassy and sort of security staff and their families were whisked out by Royal Air Force and Special Forces. Overnight, they did it, knowing the high risk. And it was a very highly secure, highly sensitive operation that they undertook. And they got them all out. Now, the British ambassador to Sudan and his entourage went there when this kicked off. They were at home. They were at home on leave. Funny that, isn't it? Funny. Because his security team, his security staff and his intelligence officers would have known that this was going to happen. So they got out, but they've left behind up to 4,000 British people out there who are now facing a really, really bad scenario, because there's fighting on the streets, there's carnage, and they face this dilemma, a choice between, do we go and get, because there's no electricity, everything's gone off. It's in the capital of Khartoum. Do we go out, try and get food and water and risk being shot, captured, and horrible things happening? Or do we just stay in here in the darkness and starve? What do we do? Well, that was the initial outcry. Now, to be fair to the British ambassador, whose name I do not know, to Sudan, he, even though he weren't there and he seems to have done a runner, like he knew what was coming, did a runner, he did foster a ceasefire agreement between these two factions, the Sudanese army and this rapid response group. Is it rapid response? Rapid support forces group. And they're in fighting. He did foster a 72-hour ceasefire. So that's 3 days. That was from Monday. Today's Tuesday. So tomorrow. So there's a window there to get these people out. Now, I said France, Germany, Italy, Spain have been doing that already, and several Britons, a good few Britons, have got out on those flights. But of course, our response has been a bit fucking slower. But it's happening. There's been Hercules transports going out from RAF Akrotiri in Cyprus, going out there, 3.5-hour flight to Sudan, and they've picked up a few today. But the operation to evacuate the Britons there now, and anyone else who's left from other Western nations, is going to be very, very difficult. The ceasefire isn't observed in all quarters. And what the British government has said, you know, look, you guys, don't go flooding yourselves to the airport, which is the military airport is not far from the Khartoum main airport. Don't go there and wait. Just when we notify you, then do a runner and try to get to the airport and we'll pick you up. But those poor people on the ground have got to negotiate checkpoints and volatile activity on the streets. It's civil war. There's complete and utter anarchy. And they've got families and kids and they've got to try to navigate that. But they'll be told, like, right now, you and your family, head there now. It's a very big logistical operation. Special forces are definitely involved in this. Now, 2021, you had the huge evacuation from Afghanistan, and what a debacle that turned out to be. But we had troops there already. We had air bases. We had stuff already there. So there was an infrastructure there. It was slipshod, and we left how many thousands of people that we should have saved who are still there under threat from the Taliban. We left them behind. The interpreters, the people who are working in intelligence gathering, but they're from Afghanistan, but they're working for the British government and the coalition forces. And we promised them safety, and we left a huge amount of them behind. And you know, they were being hunted down. But this is different. We didn't have an armed force or a presence on the ground. So that makes things very difficult. And I do appreciate, in fact, I massively appreciate that the operation that's in place right now, which is very difficult to try to get these people. Chris, we can't go into the streets. What are we gonna do? Be like Black Hawk Down. But the whole city will come down upon a convoy of British troops trying to extract people. And that's not gonna work. So, yeah, sorry about this. Sorry, folks, but we're at the airport now. We've got a Hercules C-130. Just make your way there now. We've got a window of opportunity to get you out. Leg it now. Shit. You can always say, like, you know, well, what were these people doing there in the first place? It's a volatile area. There's a lot of those states and nations in that region of the woods are. They're unstable, and they're prone to revolution and sectarian and, you know, horrendous violence. And especially if you're a Westerner there, you're not popular. You may have been at one time, oh, you know, you had servants and all sorts, and you will arrange tea on the air, on the manicured lawn, which all of you have all prepared for us. Yeah, all of you live here, but we subjugate you. Those days are long gone. They get hold of you now. It doesn't even matter what faction you're for. Westerners are massively bullseyes, they're targets. So it's a bad scenario, very bad scenario. And but flights are going out. The 72 hours will be up midnight tomorrow, I would have thought. So, but as I say, you know, certain elements of the these warring factions are not observing the ceasefire. So you're running the gauntlet. Folks, no matter what they pay you, don't come out to a war zone unless you're armed. Simple as that. Unless you're part of an armed force there. Don't be a civilian in one of these places. Oh, the money's great. It is. But when this sort of thing kicks off, and it can flare up at any time, and you could be caught there. The US left people behind in Libya to be sacrificed. They did. Hillary Clinton, blood on your hands, you bitch. Okay, so that's terrible, terrible stuff at the moment. Oh yeah, speaking of planes and things, and I've mentioned a few times about the planes that circle above this area. The little sort of two-seater planes, little turbine buzz fucking little Airfix bloody model kits flying above your head, and they're flying very low down. I mean, they are literally skipping above the battlements and turrets of Kilt Mansion. And I've mentioned it in a few of these magazine editions, and I phoned the police, and they are police. They are the Police National Air Service. Yeah, is that right? Police National Air Service planes. Now, these guys are called in when the helicopters, the police helicopters are busy elsewhere or inactive, the maintenance or whatever, they'll call the planes in, and these planes are everywhere. And I noticed this a few weeks ago, and my family were annoyed about it, because it's noisy and it's low and it goes on for fucking hours, and they're turning just a big circle. Now, admittedly, I know I've learned a bit more about this since I first reported on this, that there are police planes. I phoned the police, and well, I've discussed the ridiculousness of that conversation that was had, and the stupidity of the silly bitch that was taking my call, and Anyway, go back. I've talked about it before. I'm not going to go over that again. And but yeah, they are police planes. Now, they're serving a purpose, mostly, seemingly, helping to search for a small child who got missing in the woods. I think it was Leeds. And but a helicopter can, because we get the police helicopter as well a lot, and it can hover, put its search like that. It can hover there, or it's got a very sort of very small turning circle. But a two-seater fucking plane hasn't. It's got to do a big wide circle and then keep on doing it if it's trying to track someone on the ground. It's not as good as a helicopter, is it? But anyway, so we learned that these are this police National Air Service, which, funny enough, we'd never even known about them before a couple of weeks ago when I first reported on this. And but now they're active over, because there's been so many complaints about these. Lots of, you Google it, it'll come up. And what are these planes circling over my house? And they're all northern towns. It's like, it's Bradford, Bolton, Sheffield, Newcastle, obviously Merseyside, and other northern towns and cities that they're predominantly moving over. And people have only recently sort of noticed all this. Oh, it's already, you're thinking like, whoa, what's going on? Anyway, my mate Chris in the pub the other day. Chris looks like the young George Lucas. He's just done Star Wars. He's done THX-1138, American Graffiti, and he's just done Star Wars. And now he's like, forget James Cameron. George Lucas is the king of the world. And, somewhere far, far away in a galaxy long, long time ago. Whatever. He's a dead ringer with the beard and the sort of youthful, chubby face and sort of curly, dark hair. And he's exactly the same. And we're in a pub the day, and he went, oh, you mentioned those police National Air Service planes. I said, yeah, yeah. He said, like, I've just found a flight tracker thing on it, you know, on his app and all that. You know, you can go on your app. The wife does this all the time, and she's always forever amazed about the entire amount of planes that are in the sky at one time. And there's about 50 gazillion of them over one city at one time. And it's kind of fucking terrifying. But he went and said, look at the flight path that those planes go on. He goes, it goes right over your place. It goes right over the Kilt Mansion. And I've got the picture. And I was like, oh my God, fucking does. What a bastard. What are they up to? Now, I have been out in the back, in the grounds at the back, when it's been going over. Because it can happen of an evening for a couple of hours. It can happen in the morning, it can happen in the afternoon. There's no general consensus as to when it's going to happen. But I suppose if they're called out, genuinely called out, then, you know, it could be any time, couldn't it, I suppose? But they are in operation for hours at a time, and it's a fucking annoyance. It recedes. You think, is it gone? Comes back round again, you're like, oh, fuck off. So I've been out the back, and I've been a right little fucking jumped up little jerk off. I know I have, because I've been going, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you. And yeah, probably, because you can probably see, they can probably got technology on board, and they can probably look out the fucking window, and go, oh, there's that fucking dick in a kilt. Look at him again, knobhead. Let's go around another five times. Let's just go over his chimney pots, you know. Because we've got them really high chimney pots as well, really high, and they look precarious as all hell, but they're wonderful. They've been there since Victorian times, for God's sake, you know. They'll take a fucking police plane to dislodge them. Oh yeah, and I'll fucking sue their asses off if they do. So that's what they are, and they're still going on. And they have a flight. They seem to have a flight path which is directly over here, this place. Bastards! Because we could finite, you know, the flight path, the regular flight path, and it is over this fucking mansion. The bastards. But thanks to George Lucas for that, anyway. And his THX technology. Right. So Oh, what have we done, everything? We've only been on for 35 minutes and I haven't covered a great deal, have I? Well, there's a peeve of the week and there's an earworm, and yeah, but I will say, I would appear to have incurred the wrath of a local here who definitely does not like me and actually threatened me the other day. Threatened me in the pub, in front of many witnesses. Threatened me. Punch me. I'm going to punch you in the face. Go ahead, you might improve my fucking face if you do. He threatened me. I'm not going to go into all of this, but he threatened me twice. Come over. I'd just gone into the pub. I had a bag of meat. I just went to the butcher's and I bought loads and loads of meat as well. Like, and I thought, oh, I'll just call in and have a couple of whiskies. And I walked in and we'd already had an altercation. And I'd deliberately given a wide berth to the times that I know he's in there. So, because I thought I'll play the bigger man, because I'm not, if I walk in there and he's there, this is what I'd said for weeks to people who were going like, just go in. Don't worry about it, go in. He's nodding. And but I went, no, because I'll go in and he will say something and then I'll bite my tongue and then he'll say something else, thinking he's got power over me. And then I will sort of say something back and then it'll escalate. People go, no, well, don't worry about it. Those bastards, they fucking knew. They must have known. Come on, go in. Just please go in. So I went in, this bag of meat, I walked in and he was there with a bunch of other people that I know who are all mates of mine, who I haven't seen for a while because I've not been going in. And I went, all right, chaps, like that. And I walked straight down to the end of the bar. But before I'd even ordered my drinks, my two whiskies, he came over, got off his stool, he come over. He's a big man, you know. I'm only a short ass, but he's a big man. And he went, you've got a, it was almost like being in a Western movie. Like, you've got a nerve showing your face around these parts. Even, you've got a nerve coming back in here. By the way, I've done nothing. This is something and nothing. And he went, so you've got a nerve coming back in here. You know, I'm going to punch you in the face. And he's a big fella. And I went, and I'm also boxed into a corner as well. The bar, or the hatch is there. But I was stood at the bar. But I didn't move back. I didn't move forward, I just stood my ground. And I went, what have I done now? And he went, you know, you've got a, he said, just repeated himself, you've got a nerve coming in here. I'm gonna punch you in the face. And it looked like he was gonna do it as well. So I turned around to the bar, put my hands on the bar, and I went, I can't even get a drink in here now. I'm gonna punch you. Just the same mantra again, I'm gonna punch you. And I said, oh, so you're threatening me now. How charming is that? The problem with this guy is he's an ex-copper. Once a copper, always a copper. And he still thinks that he's got this power over people. And so, but I went, oh, so you're threatening me now? How charming. At which point he turned around and walked back to his stool and sat down again. And well, I thought, well, my meat's there. It's fucking, you know, it's going to go off, but I can't leave. Because you can't leave, can you? You can't be the one that drinks up and walks out. Although, maybe you should do. I was there for another fucking 4 hours. Lots of whiskey, a couple of pints of real ale as well. And George Lucas, Chris, because that's when Chris come in. And he went, oh, that thing about those police planes, that's when he showed me that. It was just after. He didn't even witness the incident. And in the end, he went, let's just call him Nob. His name rhymes with Nob. But Nob left. And the barmaid, I went to her, because she's still the same barmaid, although a change of staff did happen within about 5 minutes. I went to her, you heard that before, didn't you? And she went, I did, yeah. Well, can you tell the people that run the pub? And she went, I'm going to. She said, oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't do anything. Well, what would you have done exactly? You know, you're not a doorman, are you? You know, but maybe she should have said something, I don't know. But she didn't, and she said, I was genuinely frightened. and I thought he was going to do it. I generally thought he was going to hit you. I said he was going to hit me. He was going to hit me. But I wouldn't have retaliated unless he actually made contact. I would have hopefully, he says this, hopefully, because he's a big fella, and it'd be well announced, ducked under that swing, and the fucker would have lost his balance and fallen over and done his back in on a stool or something, or on the deck. Probably had a heart attack. That place has recently got a defibrillator in there as well. So that would have been a great little TV sort of... In a lighter note, a pub bully had to be defibrillated, you know. And it would have been me with the fucking paddles going, yeah, fuck you, on his fucking testicles, yeah, bastard, you know. But, yeah. It's a weird one though, folks. Not even like 5 years ago, I would have been far more proactive. But I don't want to rock the boat. I'm older now, and I don't want to be causing a scene. Says the guy that caused a scene in fucking Monte Carlo. With the local guard force, gendarmerie. But, you know, it's not a wise thing. If you can defuse a potentially violent situation, do so. Do so, because you will not come off any better for smacking someone in the face, breaking someone's jaw. As I was told yesterday, put your finger in his eye. This is another mate of mine, 30 years in the army. He said, he goes, I don't worry about getting barred from pubs. He goes, I've been barred from countries. He's fucking sensational. He's a great, great lad. And he went, I'm not going to mention the name of the pub. He said, do you fancy a walk up there now? And I went, no, don't do it. It's only going to get worse. Don't do it. So, but yeah, these are things. That, bizarrely, that's not the pet peeve of the week. It isn't. You know, dickheads who launch themselves upon you over ridiculous, stupid, bloody nothing event, a nothing scenario, and then come gunning for you. When I'd actually kept away, and it should have been a case of like, well, live and let live. Let's forget about that. Well, obviously not, you know. Old coppers don't forget, do they? So what is the peeve of the week then? Okay, the peeve of the week is, right, it's Poles. No, I don't mean Polish people. And I don't mean that thing that firemen come sliding down to come and, you know, get in a fire engine and put your fires out. I don't mean that at all. Poles, P-O-L-L-S. These impromptu polls that TV and media do, which is just complete bollocks. It's, you know, is it a slow news day? Oh, and there's been a poll today. You know, men with one big ear, one small ear, tend to listen to their phone in the big ear. Yeah. How much said yes? How much said no? 75% big ear. It's just, it's fucking bullshit. And the thing that got me today was this. The most dunkable biscuit in Britain. Dunkable in a cup of tea, right? Because, you know, in England, we dunk our biscuits in tea. Yes, we do. And I do. And I can tell you right now, the fucking best biscuit to dunk in tea. Well, there's two. There's the hobnob, not the chocolate hobnob, for reasons I will come into, and the ginger nut. Yes, from my family tree, the ginger nut. They're best because they hold, and like you go, and it just goes, and it melts in your mouth. Wonderful. So a poll was taken, and what do you think won the poll? Controversy, much controversy here. It was the Jaffa cake biscuit. What did I just do there? I highlighted the point about the controversy. It's called a Jaffa cake. It's a little light sort of fluffy base with a Jaffa orange filling with a light covering of chocolate. They've been going for many years. They're wonderful. In 2015, I think it was, McVitie's, who make them, had to go to court to say whether it was a biscuit or a cake, because this was like a huge sort of thing, a thing in Britain, a thing where I, you know, well, Jaffa cakes, are they biscuits or are they cakes? And they are an unusual little breed of confectionery. They come in a biscuit style pack like that, so they're all stacked up vertically in like cellophane on the inside of a cardboard package. Jaffa cakes. The fucking clue's in the name. It's called a Jaffa cake. It's a cake in a little biscuit sort of circular style, you know, rendering. They're not biscuits. Biscuits are fucking hard and crusty, and they've got like, there's a crunch to them. It's a biscuit, you know? You don't call a fucking fig roll a biscuit, do you? Or do you? Are they called fig roll biscuits? By the way, I hate figs, but I love fig rolls. Go figure. I hate that horrible stuff inside a mince pie, a Christmas mince pie. But I love mince pies because I love the sugary pastry which manages to get round that horrible, nasty fucking insectoid detritus that's living within. But I can eat a mince pie till the cows come home. And I can eat Jaffa cakes and I can eat fig rolls because they're wrapped up in something better. No, the Jaffa cakes are actually gorgeous. They are gorgeous. Well, they won. The most dunkable biscuit in Britain got voted for as the Jaffa cake. Is this what the... It was all over. The radio, the news, fucking TV, all this morning. Fucking Jaffa cakes. And the people were on TV shows and they're doing little experiments. They had a plate of biscuits and they had a cup of tea. Do you know how they did this? How this scientific observation was made and the poll was won? They dunked biscuits, a variety of biscuits, into not tea. A cup, mug of hot water. I don't know what the degree was, but hot water. You're not even using tea. But the one that won was a Jaffa cake. And it could be dunked, I think. Now, I could be wrong about the figure here, but it was something like this. 117 times without falling apart. Most biscuits, you dunk them, and it's part of the game that you play. Dunking a biscuit is a uniquely wonderful experience. But it's exciting. It's fraught with tension. And, like, you know, you could be dunking, yeah, and you get distracted. Oh, yeah. Coronation Street, yeah. And you go, oh, it's been here for too long. And you pull it out, and you go, and the whole fucking thing, half the biscuit, and folds and collapses into your tea. So not only have you lost, you know, that lovely dunked bit of biscuit, but it's all in there, in like, like sediments, and it's floating around. And it's like, oh, it's destroyed your cup of tea. But it's fun because it's a little bit of jeopardy. It's an added bit of taste and fun with your cup of tea and your biscuits. But there is an added element of danger in there as well. It could all go fucking tits up. But not so with the Jaffa cake, apparently. It could be dunked for about 12... I think the time was like 12 minutes. I could be wrong about that. But they did it on the TV and they were all going... And like the time-honoured dunkables were like rich tea. Don't use a fucking rich tea biscuit. It's like fucking confetti. You know, it's called rich tea, and they are quite nice in a very bland sort of way. But because they're bland, they're very Moorish. Do you understand what I mean? I don't know. But you dunk them. But literally, it's a second because it just goes. The tea just goes, and if you gotta go and get it to your gob, otherwise it's fucking down. Down your front, down your beard, it's in your hair, it's all over the fucking table, in your lap. dangerous times. Hot dunked biscuit in your crotch. Not always good. Not always good, but sometimes. But for me, chocolate should never be dunked in anything hot other than your gob. Don't put, like, McVitie's digestives are fabulous. I love them. I love the chocolate digestives. I love the plain ones. Because what you do, you know, it's circular and you've got this covering of chocolate. You've got the milk chocolate and you've got the plain chocolate. But the plain chocolate holds together better, I think. Milk chocolate, you can't do what I'm about to describe with. And what you do, you get the chocolate side on the top, and you go like that, and you kind of do an underbite, and it will leave a little ledge of chocolate, which you then go with your tongue and take that bit of chocolate off. Everyone's different, everyone's got their own ways. And like, but oh, I love that. And you go, and you've got that little sliver of plain chocolate on the roof of your mouth. Just push your tongue against it, and it just go, perfection. Not the same with milk. It doesn't hold as well milk chocolate, I don't think, with that particular attack I just described. But I'm not going to put either one of those bastards into anything hot and liquid, because I don't like melted chocolate. I like fondue. I don't even like that. I like my cup of tea, something chocolatey. Drink. I don't have sugar in my tea. Have a swig of your tea, and that is sweetening your tea, and it's just, overall taste is just, but it's the that bit and then that bit, not the ka-dunk and that bit with chocolate. If it's a plain biscuit, it works. You dunk your biscuit, you try to catch it quickly. Great, that works. But, so you can see my problem with this fucking Jaffa cake winning. A, it's not a biscuit, been proven legally in court. It's not a biscuit, it's a cake. McVitie's went to court over this. It's a fucking cake. So end of, it's not a biscuit. So it shouldn't even be in the running. It shouldn't be involved in this fucking poll. And yet it was involved, and it fucking won. And it's chocolate, and it's got like a little sort of center of a center layer of orangey flavored whatever the hell it is. God, I wish I had one now. I wish I had some to. I wish I'd thought about this in advance. Note to self: make notes in advance and get all the appropriate props. Yeah, okay. I didn't write nothing down there at all, and I will forget it in a second. But would have been great to have had a cup of tea, a big mug of tea, and a variety of biscuits and seen exactly what they're going on. But I watched them do it on TV just earlier, and what a travesty. And no one liked the Jaffa cake melted in the tea. So who the fuck was asked in this poll? This is what I'm saying. These polls that they come up with, these ridiculous, someone just in the newsroom just made it up, and then it went out to all the papers and all the news outlets. Oh, and it's took this. Did any of you get polled on this? You always hear this on TV, like in a poll, in a recent survey. I don't know anyone that ever gets asked to answer the question in a poll or a survey. Maybe it's because most people I know, like myself, when someone stops you in the street with a little clipboard and goes, oh, good day. Good day. Oh, it's a lovely day, isn't it? Can I ask you to go, fuck off. Maybe that's it. Maybe it's the only people that do not go, fuck off, and go, no, I've got nothing else to do. So what's the questions? Yeah. And they're going to be fucking the retards and sad, lonely asses who want someone to talk to. You know. Another note to self, don't be denouncing sad, lonely bastards. Everyone needs a friend. So these things can't be genuinely, factually correct, you know. And I just fucking hate them, folks. I really do. Polls like this. And whatever country you're in, you're watching this now, whatever country, you'll know what I'm talking about. It's always a little feature on a news program, or in a paper or a magazine. In a recent survey, a recent poll was conducted. Oh, fuck off. You know, it's a shite. Jaffa cakes are not biscuits. They're not. They're gorgeous, but they shouldn't be dunked in tea. Don't dunk chocolate in tea. There will be people going like, well, I do, Kilt-Man, and I like it. Well, fine for you, not for me. All right? I dunk it in whiskey. And then you make a liqueur out of it. Yeah. I've been playing Trevor Jones' score for the, was it mid-90s? So look, 1998 TV, I think it was two episodes of Merlin, with Sam Neill playing Merlin, the magician, the wizard, the King Arthur. And it's a wonderful, great, great show. And Trevor Jones did the score, and it's phenomenal. I've loved it. I've loved for many, many years. I've loved it. So we're coming on to the earworm of the week. This is when I play you a bit of music which is designed to get inside your cranium and screw you up, and it just plays around in your head for the rest of the week. And it isn't that. it's nothing to do with Merlin whatsoever. But it is something else, and it ties into a big review which I'm going to be doing very shortly for a 1980 gruesome war movie, Vietnam War movie, called The Last Hunter, with David Warbeck, Aussie actor David Warbeck, who tying in with ANZAC Day, of course, who did lots of Italian and Euro sleazy horror movies, worked in The Beyond with Lucio Fulci, and he did loads of movies. He was in lots of TV shows as well, and he's great. He was a model as well, and sadly died at a very young age, cancer, I'm sure it was. And but he made this early on in the whole sort of 80s slew of Vietnam War movies. You'd had The Deer Hunter, obviously. You'd had Coming Home, you'd had Big Wednesday, you'd had a few things, which Apocalypse Now, but the 80s would usher in like First Blood, Rambo, and oh god, fucking so many, Missing in Action, oh yeah, the Vietnam thing, and Platoon, and Hamburger Hill, and oh I've got Full Metal Jacket, you get Vietnam, fucking, you drown in Vietnam. And but Antonio Margheriti, Italian exploitation director of horrors and thrillers, he did this, and I love it. Now I'm going to do a big review of this movie in the next few days, and it is great. It incurred the wrath of the DPP for the video nasty list. Yeah, it wasn't banned. It didn't. People go like, oh, it was banned. It wasn't banned. It was brought in and was put under scrutiny and investigated, and But it became notorious because of its depiction of graphic violence in it. But it's actually a really good film, and it tells a quite crazy but good story, which I'm not going to go into right now because I'm going to review the film properly. But the score by, I forgot his name, and Franco Michelizzi, did this great sort of semi-electronic and synthesized score, but with orchestral elements. But he does a theme which, for it's one of the greatest bits of music I've heard to depict sweaty, horrible jungles, and the jungle that David Warbeck has to go into on his special mission behind enemy lines. It's not the most pleasant. Put it this way. Johnny Rambo, you never saw him in the jungle quite as nasty as this fucking jungle. And this was all, when he went back for Rambo First Blood Part 2, when he went back to Nam, what you call hell, he calls home. It was lovely. It was fucking Mexico, wasn't it? It wasn't even remotely fucking Vietnamese. But this, filmed in like Indochina, I think it was, like, it's fucking horrible, and you can feel the sweat drips off the screen, and you're like when you're watching it, you're just like, you're baking away there. But right, this theme, which is not that one, is it this one? Sorry, I've just noticed that, another note to self, when you finally, you know, arrive at an earworm of the week, make sure you can read what the fucking track titles are, because they're all in Italian and they all say the same fucking thing. It's just section 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever. But here you go, I think this is it. It's very 80s. It's got like wow 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 stuff. And these will be travelogues of him and the people that he meets who join forces with him. there's that sluggish rhythm and beat going through turgid swamps and insects incessantly at you, and these little calls and warbles. There's a very synthesized quality to it, and yet there's actually instruments being used. Like bird calls, aren't they? Tisa Farrow's in this movie as well. And Tony King was a champion of blaxploitation movies. And with a lot of Italian stuff as well, even Cannibal Holocaust and stuff like that. And he was always dubbed in the Italians, always overdubbed. But he's good. He's great in this. His name's changed now. He's become some Islamic, I don't know. He's Malik Farrakhan. But he's great in this. He's great in everything. Sounds jazzy, it's like they've just gone off on a bit of a tangent, but slow. It's just got this sluggish sort of, I don't know, impetus. Okay. Oh, not that one. That's a slightly sped up version. A bit more funky. 1980, but obviously it's very infused with this, the progressive sound of the 70s and the funky sort of jazzy fusion. But given that Franco Michelizzi is Italian, it's got that, you know, Euro flavour to it as well. And I love it, I think it's great. It is funky. Warbeck's great in this movie. I will really give it a load of plaudits. That's jazz, isn't it? That's pure jazz. That's like John Carpenter in full lounge mode. Funky time! Vietnam! But I'm a mean black mother! It's a little bit of a brass comes in there as well. It doesn't conjure up Vietnam, does it? Not really. And booby trap, horrendous booby traps, and rats, and being trapped in a fucking cage in a typhoid-ridden river with rats eating people alive. I love this sort of, it's hypnotic, and they go, whoa. Love that. It does evoke jungles and mystery, yeah. You feel hot and steamy and sweaty. Mm-hmm. that little pops, and like it's like you're stepping on like I don't know, leeches, and they're popping. Big fat mosquitoes have just been sucking, you know, your whiskey sodden blood, and they're going zzz, fucking banging into trees. So folks, that was the magazine edition. Anzac Day, Armageddon alarms, people threatening in the pub, fireman's poles, ridiculous chocolate biscuit dunking poles, rendered obsolete by the fact that the one that won is actually a cake, not a fucking biscuit. Evacuation in Sudan. They've got another day of this. It'll end tomorrow. The ceasefire ends tomorrow at midnight. That is a nightmarish scenario to get out of. It really is. But as I say, the people that are out there, you must have known that this could potentially be an outcome, a situation you might have to live through and survive. You wouldn't go. Sudan's not exactly a fucking tourist hotspot, is it? Let's be honest, you know. And we have, the police planes go right over the Kilt Mansion on purpose. I have trouble with an ex-copper, and the police planes are going over my mansion. And does he work for McVitie's now? Does he? It's all connected! I tell ya. It's a good score, isn't it? It's a good atmospheric score. So folks, anyway, I have been always shall be killed, man. Please, in the meantime, in this ever jungly dunking biscuit in between time, please keep it Kilted, keep it Celtic. Be happy, be yourselves. Don't worry about a damn thing that's out there. It's not what happens, it's how you deal with what happens. And that's how you survive. So folks, please, keep it Kilted, keep it Celtic. I'm going to see you all. Italians ever fight in Vietnam? I don't know. The Aussies did, so David Warbeck's okay.